Blackstone Audiobooks presents
A Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court by Mark Twain. Preface. The ungentle laws and customs touched upon in this tale are historical, and the episodes which are used to illustrate them are also historical. It is not pretended that these laws and customs existed in England in the 6th century. No, it is only pretended that inasmuch as they existed in English and other civilizations of far later times, it is safe to consider that it is no liable upon the 6th century to suppose them to have been in practice in that day also. One is quite justified in inferring that, wherever one of these laws or customs was lacking in that remote time, its place was competently filled by a worse one. The question as to whether there is such a thing as divine right of kings is not settled in this book. It was found too difficult. That the executive head of a nation should be a person of lofty character and extraordinary ability was manifest and indisputable. That none but the deity could select that head unerringly was also manifest and indisputable. That the deity ought to make that selection, then, was likewise manifest and indisputable. Consequently, that he does make it, as claimed, was unavoidable deduction. I mean, until the author of this book encountered the Pompadour and Lady Castlemaine, and some other executive heads of that kind. These were found so difficult to work into the scheme that it was judged better to take the other tack in this book, which must be issued this fall, and then go into training and settle the question in another book. It is, of course, a thing which ought to be settled, and I'm not going to have anything particular to do next winter anyway. Mark Twain, Hartford, July 21st, 1889. A word of explanation. It was in Warwick Castle that I came across the curious stranger who I'm going to talk about. He attracted me by three things: his candid simplicity, his marvellous familiarity with ancient armour, and the restfulness of his company, for he did all the talking. We fell together, as modest people will, in the tail of the herd that was being shown through, and he at once began to say things which interested me. As he talked along, softly, pleasantly, flowingly, he seemed to drift away imperceptibly out of this world and time, and into some remote era and old forgotten country. And so he gradually wove such a spell about me that I seemed to move among the spectres and shadows and dust and mould of a grey antiquity, holding speech with a relic of it. Exactly as I would speak of my nearest personal friends or enemies or my most familiar neighbours, he spoke of Sir Bedivere, Sir Bors de Ganis, Sir Lancelot of the Lake, Sir Galahad, and all the other great names of the Table Round. And how old, old, unspeakably old, and faded, and dry, and musty, and ancient he came to look as he went on. Presently he turned to me and said, just as one might speak of the weather or any other common matter, "You know about transmigration of souls? Do you know about transposition of epochs and bodies?" I said I had not heard of it. He was so little interested, just as when people speak of the weather, that he did not notice whether I made him an answer or not. There was half a moment of silence, immediately interrupted by the droning voice of the salaried cicerone. "Ancient hauberk, date of the 6th century, time of King Arthur and the Round Table, said to have belonged to the knight Sir Sagramour le Désirous. Observe the round hole through the chain mail in the left breast. Can't be accounted for. Supposed to have been done with a bullet since invention of firearms, perhaps maliciously by Cromwell's soldiers." My acquaintance smiled. Not a modern smile, but one that must have gone out of general use many, many centuries ago, and muttered, apparently to himself, "Wit ye well, I saw it done." Then, after a pause, added, "I did it myself." By the time I had recovered from the electric surprise of this remark, he was gone. All that evening I sat by my fire at the Warwick Arms, steeped in a dream of the olden time, while the rain beat upon the windows and the wind roared about the eaves and corners. From time to time I dipped into old Sir Thomas Malory's enchanting book and fed at its rich feast of prodigies and adventures, breathed in the fragrance of its obsolete names, and dreamed again. Midnight being come at length, I read another tale for a nightcap, this which here follows, to wit, How Sir Lancelot Slew Two Giants and Made a Castle Free. Anon withal there came there upon him two great giants well armed, all save the heads, with two horrible clubs in their hands. Sir Lancelot put his shield afore him, and put the stroke away of the one giant, and with his sword he clave his head asunder. When his fellow saw that, he ran away as he were wood, demented, for fear of the horrible strokes, and Sir Lancelot after him with all his might.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.